Hi, folks. I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
I'm Pablo.
I'm Scott.
We are Armchair Directors.
And it ain't the years, honey. It's the mileage.
Welcome to another commentary. And this is a great movie to pop in these days. Something just fun, exciting, rip-roaring. And we're very happy that you chose to listen along to us, invite us into your homes, and have this commentary running, because these commentaries can be really fun to add on to movies you've seen dozens or hundreds of times. And it's going to be fun chatting today with our guests on the commentary. Scott, the Big Heel, how are you doing, good brother?
Very well. How are you guys holding up?
Very good, very good. And Pablo from Chile. Scott's from Ottawa, and Pablo's from Chile. How are things out in Chile?
Well, same that any part of the world right now. So we are, all my family is in home, fortunately. So we are holding up there.
Yeah. So
what about you?
Same. It's the same worldwide. And that's the really interesting thing about this. Everyone's going through the same thing. So everyone's really relating to each other very well. Don't do what Indy does in this movie. No traveling. So you can vicariously travel through Dr. Jones.
No ticket.
We're gonna fire this thing up. We have paused it right as the A Paramount Picture logo has faded in from black with the stars going around it. Give you a countdown from 3, 2, 1, play, and on play, you'll press play. Ready?
Ready.
And yes. 3, 2, 1, play.
The good old-fashioned Paramount Pictures logo.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
And what I love with the indie movies is they always do a match cut from the logo to something.
Yeah.
And this is to that mountain. You know, Crystal Skull is the gopher mound or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's always a classic. Doing a match cut like that, classic Spielberg.
The character evolved so much from the first movie. I remember seeing this movie as a kid. I think I saw it after Temple of Doom. But it definitely, like, he's gruffer. He's more rough around the edges.
Mm-hmm.
In this movie,
and yeah, he's definitely
more of like an action hero in the second and third one.
Yeah, this was still a little bit more grounded than the movies would get. You know, he became, especially in part two, he feels like he's a little bit of a superhero. But I just love that, you know, this such gorgeous way to introduce this movie with the forest and just walking where we don't see anybody really in close up. We just mostly see them from behind. So we see Indy's silhouette with that hat. And of course, Alfred Molina, Doc Ock, yeah, as one of the guys leading them through the forest here, the jungle, is awesome.
Yeah. This is the second one in the canon, right? Because Temple of Doom is the prequel of this movie.
That's right.
Yeah, chronological, this actually takes place after.
It makes no difference what order you
watch.
Do you think you need to watch the third one last? Probably best to watch the third one last.
I would say, Last Crusade last. Yeah.
Well, and then, I'm not counting Crystal Skull. And
that's
well,
right.
So.
Yeah.
Last Crusade was the perfect ending. So.
Yeah, sure.
We just saw Frank Marshall's name pop up. That's Mr. Kathleen Kennedy. He's Kathleen Kennedy's husband. Doc Ock.
Yep. That's how you always check if it's poison. You taste it.
Yeah.
I just love that. Like, that makes no sense. I don't know.
You'd think he'd stick it in his neck. Oh, it's poison. Ovitos. Pablo,
this must be the first work of Alfred Molina, perhaps. Who knows?
Yeah,
he looks so different.
How old were you when you saw this, Pablo, first time?
Hold on a sec.
I love the light shadow and the smoke. You're 8.
8 years old?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm way ahead. I was listening to you. I was like 12 years old, perhaps a little younger, but I was thinking about this during the day, and the wonderment of this movie, you know, because I am very fond of all of these kind of tales. This part of this world is not like those stories in those movies, right? It's another culture. So mm-hmm. you are really hit by the wonderment of, you know, the world, because you know this is a place that have a lot of mysteries, and you know it's possible. And I think it's a great story for that age to be amazed of those mysteries, right?
Yeah.
Anybody here familiar with the serials that inspired this movie?
Just in general, seeing like clips years later of some of the stuff, but not extensively. No. Mm. I love that moment where Indy uses his whip for the first time and comes into the light. It's that hero moment, like, hey, here we go. This is the hero, in case you hadn't figured it out.
Yeah, and we're so used to him at this point, but I remember as a kid seeing that shot, seeing his introduction and going, he doesn't look like a hero to me. He's scruffy. He's scowling. He was Han Solo in Star Wars, but he's not acting like Han, all smarmy and charming. He's not, right. He's not a scoundrel in Raiders. A little more so in the other indie movies, but in this one, he's dead serious. He's a grave robber, tomb raider.
He is a tomb raider.
And it's very different from his, in a way, alter ego when he's a professor and all of that, because I don't know, I can feel in his performance that in as a professor is more calm down, you know, and this is full adventure. It's great.
He's this really makes the snake joke even funnier, because covered with spiders. No problem.
Oh, I hate that scene. I hate this scene.
I love this because it's classic Indiana Jones, right? The creepy crawlies. Yeah. And
I hate spiders, but I mean...
You're arachnophobic.
Yeah.
Now, how does this thing work?
Arachnophobia, directed by Frank Marshall.
How does this... how does this trap work? How can something be light activated after decades or hundreds of years?
I don't know. I just go with it. That, as a kid, that was like one of the moments where you're like, this movie is scary. Like, this is going to be fun, but this is not your standard fare for a six-year-old at this point.
Yeah, Forresto. So this is a dude he knows. Music is so awesome.
Yeah.
It's the music that makes it fun, because it's a serious situation, and Harrison... is so like monotone, at least in the first part of this movie. He's just got that deep voice. Like, he's not doing the Han, well, why don't you? Da, da, da.
Yeah.
So it's the music that really keeps it bubbly. Make it sound happy.
Yeah. And, you know, like anything John Williams works on, his contribution doubles the results, right?
This, Matt, is what you refer to as Spielberg. Is it filming the hell out of something?
Oh, yeah.
Shooting the hell out of something. There's already been so many shots of the camera just slowly walking towards a character. Almost like that shot from Jaws, the zoom in, walk back. Or walk back, zoom in, whichever one it is. Like, everything is epic in this intro.
And this is one of those scenes that everything has been thought out so perfectly that the framing and just the way the edits are for maximum impact when stuff goes wrong in a few minutes. Which is why it's one of the most iconic movie openings of all time.
Yeah.
Did you guys ever do this thing when you were kids? The
always
swapping the idol for the bag of sand, bag of cereal. You're trying to get like the cookies and swap it with a bag of oatmeal.
Got to do the perfect swap.
Looking, paying attention to the floor, all that kind of stuff.
How is he gauging the weight of this?
And that's why it doesn't work, right? Like he literally, this is all for show. He doesn't know what he's doing. And like I said, this one of the most iconic scenes. This is also one of the most parodied scenes. This and the boulder coming up.
UHF,
probably in history. Yeah. And even just like award shows and stuff, they always do an Indiana Jones grabbing the idol, running from the ball parody.
Yeah.
cultural touchstone.
Uh-huh, practical effects.
So good. And, you know, as much as people rag on Crystal Skull, that's the main thing that actually makes it less exciting, is so much of the finale is not practical. It's CGI. This feels tactile. I actually feel like they're in danger.
They are.
Yeah.
They literally are.
Oh, Doc Ock, what a jerk.
Yeah.
Once a villain, always a villain. That's probably why they hired him for Spider-Man. Get me that guy who just betrayed Indy. But he's only in the movie for 2 minutes. I don't care. Get him. He's our villain.
He's the guy. And this is
a little, you know, Han Solo peeking out there.
The comedy in the action, the tenseness, and just that moment where the rope starts going, the vine is comical.
Yeah.
And this is a great.
Oh.
Again, this is telling you this is an intense movie. It's a fun adventure, but stuff can happen.
Now, I always thought, like, if he just went the other way, the boulder would completely miss him, but I guess he'd be trapped in here.
Trapped.
Yeah, that's. I was just thinking that. Yeah, he'd be trapped.
There's sunlight coming in, so there could have been a way out.
He probably could have found a way out, but it wouldn't have looked as cool.
No. And this really sets the stage for what kind of hero Indy is. He's not, what's the term, OP? He's not a Gary Stu. Oh, that's going to sting in the morning. But he loses the treasure right away. It's kind of like a hard luck type of hero.
Yeah, and it subverts your expectation, because after all of that exciting opening, you think, oh, this guy's getting his treasure and he's getting away. And then, nope, he gets robbed. And one of the real villains of the movie is introduced.
I remember seeing Indiana Jones when I was a kid and being kind of confused. Like, how can he be Indiana Jones? He's Han Solo. Not really understanding the concept of an actor being able to play multiple roles.
Yeah.
So that was kind of a little bit of baggage I had to overcome. Like, but it's so fake. He's Han Solo. He's not Indy. Like, no, he's an actor. He's an actor. He's allowed to play different characters.
He's allowed to do both.
And then I saw Blade Runner and went, what the heck? He's not Indy or Han in that one.
No doubt.
He's bored. There's Jacques.
I love this part.
This is just a great shot. He's so dusty. Priceless. Coming over the hill and then the million people behind him.
I love his run. It's not like a gravedigger's or adventure guy's run. It is a professor's run.
Yeah.
And I love this physical comedy, you know, because sometimes I see too much of a verbal comedy. You try to be smart than the other guy, you know, smart dialogue, and you can be easily go too far with that.
Absolutely. And I love
kind of physical comedy.
He's so clumsy. He didn't even stick the landing on the vine there. He just kind of dumped down. it was a refreshing change. And every time I see this movie, it's refreshing that he's not like a perfect type of gymnast. Like, he's just getting by with the skin of his teeth.
Yeah.
Here we go.
And that's funny, because we've seen how much this guy has already gone through, and that's the thing that gets him. Reggie.
Denholm Elliott, Marcus Class Brody. Yeah. Now, this is something they dropped, I think, in the third movie, didn't they? Where he's kind of a heartthrob for the female students.
Well, they did drop it by then because he was getting a little bit older. But I like this. This is just one of those weird, like, they threw this in. It's like a totally Spielbergian kind of moment with that girl with the thing on her eyelids. So random, but it shows you how his perception is at school.
Mm-hmm. Like, the whole class is just googly eyes at him.
Yeah. Well, they still kind of do it in Last Crusade, don't they? Like, they still all go to his office, and he has to sneak out the window.
Oh.
But the bloom is off the rose then, because they're all just confused, and they actually want help with their homework, because he's not doing that good a job at teaching at that point.
Yeah. Wow. Huh? Nice little moment there. The eyelids.
Yeah, it's classic.
One of my favorite parts about that old computer game, Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis, was the intro where he had to go through the university searching for one of his old artifacts. And he kept falling through floor after floor of the university. Marcus is so much more serious in the first movie too, and dignified, and he is the comic relief in the third movie.
He is, yeah.
Yeah.
They really do make him a bit of a clown later, but
I love that.
Denholm does such a good job that it works.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is he finally leaving the adventure, right?
Yeah, I really appreciated the return of both Marcus Brody and Sala in the third movie.
Oh, Sala, so good.
I still can't believe they didn't bring back Sala for Crystal Skull.
Kind of inexcusable, really.
There must be some sort of personal issue going on there, because I just don't know how you don't work him in. He better be in the fifth one.
He's got Lord of the Rings money now. He doesn't need this anymore.
He better be in the fifth, and that's not a threat. That's a request. Yeah, the Gimli. And that Sliders money. Don't forget that.
That's right.
He's living out that Sliders money.
They sold a few of those DVDs. I've been watching Sliders on DVD, really enjoying the first season and a half. But I think you can see the precise moment John Rhys-Davies stopped caring. In the second season, he's like, get me off the show. You blistering idiot.
The Kari Wurr effect.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that now. This guy, that's Porkins. I remember this now. Yeah, he's Porkins in Star Wars.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Cover me, Porkins. I'm going in. Yeah, I really liked how these Lucasfilm regulars would pop up in the different movies.
Yeah, that's a nice sense of family to it.
Getting a lot more screen time than he did in Star Wars here.
Yeah, big time.
And the other guy was the Emperor.
No, no way.
Wasn't he? A very similar plot to the third one. Got to go find Abner. He's the key to all this. Just like, got to go find Dad.
Mm-hmm. Which, of course, ended up... The third one is very similar to this in structure, but having that dynamic of father and son adds another layer that makes it feel fresh.
Yeah, and when we get to that, it'll be very obvious. What do you do with an aging Indy to try to make him seem a little more youthful? Well, put him next to an older Indy, like his dad. His dad was 15 years older than him.
Very effective, though.
Yeah, it worked great. Yeah. It really did. Like, even though he was older, it made him seem more like a punk, just disobeying his dad and disrespecting his dad.
Mm-hmm.
Slap across the face. That's for blush for me. This is a bit of a dry scene. I mean, especially after what we just saw. I've always thought this is like, wow, it's the camera's far back. It's really, it's not moving like it was before. And it's just a lot of talking.
Yeah. Well, and it's one of those things where, like, you know, they need to establish the stakes of the MacGuffin going forward. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of like, when you've seen this movie multiple times, these scenes are not necessarily the highlight, right?
I don't think I mean, knew what was going on until the 10th time I watched this movie and actually, like, didn't doze off during the scene. And then went, oh my God, it's all here. All the info you need is here.
When I was a kid, I dig all those scenes. I mean, it's a lot of mythology and folklore and story, and I was very amazed for hearing them.
Mm-hmm.
It's not boring to me, at least. It's Indiana Jones plot, right?
Yeah. And this probably inspired a lot of video games. Now he's laying down the sequence. We need the staff. We need the headpiece. We need the room. You need to satisfy these conditions. Porkins is like, I'm loving this movie. I'm going to get a bigger paycheck than Star Wars. I've been here at least 5 minutes. It's really cool getting a precursor to this so that when we actually see it, like, oh, yeah. Nazis. I hate those guys.
Having Nazis be the villain was just a stroke of genius, because who doesn't hate the Nazis?
Nazis, right? I love that music coming in just to make it a little bit eerie, a little scary. It's just a simple picture, but it's this thing is bad news.
Mm-hmm. And this is the important stuff, because it really sets the stage for later. Yeah, you know, an army that carries the Ark is invincible, and lays the groundwork for the stakes to come.
Nice wheels. What kind of car is that?
Beautiful car.
I do love their relationship. They got a great, Marcus and Indy have a great rapport together.
Yeah. As giddy as a schoolgirl.
I think in the fourth one there is a picture of Brody here, right?
Yes. So there's a thing that lets us know he's passed away, and
the fourth what? There was a fourth one? I didn't know there was a fourth one, but I'm looking forward to the fifth one. Maybe they'll do something with time travel where they erase the fourth one. Days of Future Past type of thing. Indiana Jones and the Days of Future Past. I like that he's packing the whip.
And I think it was a cool decision to have it be, you know, this kind of like religious artifact that people have vaguely had a history with before they would go to this movie. They might have heard of it. And so that raises the stakes a little bit when it's something, you know, that people know. It's like why the Da Vinci Code was so popular, because it was an Indiana Jones movie set within a world that people knew.
It's like an existing legend instead of creating a new one, which kind of the Shankara Stones, even though I think they were a real legend, no one had heard of it.
Yeah, it was a big difference. You know, the Holy Grail and the Ark of the Covenant are both things that, even if you aren't well-versed, you've probably heard of them.
Now, guys, is this a different fedora? I think that's his travel fedora. But it's it's weird that he would... I don't think that's the brown fedora he wears with his...
It's almost gray.
Yeah. Yeah, I always thought it looked gray. Like, that's kind of weird to pack two fedoras. I always thought, like, it should be his brown fedora that's in his leather jacket getup.
Mm-hmm. He's a man with multiple hats.
He wears, well, not many hats. He wears two hats.
Yeah.
He does not wear a hat when he's teaching. So don't do this, folks. No traveling.
So here there is a cop-out in episode 9, actually, in this kind of animation of the airplane traveling, right?
Episode 9?
Yeah.
What's it's, episode? they made a ninth one?
Yeah.
That scene was kind of an homage to the Indiana Jones style of travel.
Right. Somebody cue the Hall & Oates. You're out of touch.
I love this scene. This is one of my favorite parts of the movie already. So,
Big Heel, how excited were you to see Harley Race with a cameo appearance in this movie? It's your turn, Missy. No one can drink more whiskey than me on God's green earth.
This is one of my favorite character introductions in a movie, and the fact that it is a woman is like it just subverts your expectations, but it shows you how tough Marion Ravenwood is. And if somebody's going to be a match for Indy, we got to know that she can hold her own in a situation like this. And just Karen Allen is adorable, and that smile as she's doing this, it's just like, yeah, take it, you idiot, you lost. Oh.
And if you want to smash someone over with the crowd, you have them go over Harley Race, 7-time NWA World Heavyweight Champion. Nobody beats me, Daddy.
Let me tell you something, Ric Flair.
Oh, Harley, you're taking the bump, bumping for the business.
Never get sore.
Now, was she doing the flare trick where she was throwing the booze over her shoulder into a potted plant?
I think she was going for it, man.
Built up a tolerance. Is this...
And I just love, this is another classic shot. Man, the shadow.
How many movies do you get two classic intros to the same character? They just really know how to make this guy literally seem larger than life.
Yeah.
Big shadow silhouette. So their past relationship is a little on the icky side as the years have gone by. Different time back then, especially the year that this movie is set in, 40s, right?
Yeah.
I think this is set in the late 30s or early 40s. But he hooked up with her when she was a child.
She was a child in love.
I was just going to say, fairly young. What was she like? 15, 13?
I think she means a child of like 19 years old.
I always took it to mean like she's pretty young here. She's not even 30 here. And if it's been 10 years, if she's like, let's say 26 here, 27,
yeah,
she was 16, 15, 16?
No. 25, like you said, 26.
Okay. So yeah, she would have been 15 or 16 when he hooked up with her.
Right.
Yeah.
Different time.
Not just 80s, but 40s.
Yeah.
Is anyone going to help Harley?
Nope.
He's going to do the stretcher job.
He's really selling it. Everybody left the bar and went over to the Rambo stick fighting. Same Himalayan village.
Harley's waiting for Funk to show up so they can have an empty bar match. He is kind of a scumbag walking in here after all this time. I need your help.
Yeah, he's very stereotyped in a way, you know, like a real winner guy, you know. It's a cool professor, everybody loves him, and of course has the best way to talk with women, right?
Yeah, he's kind of scoundrel like here. Oh, that lighting is so awesome.
Yeah, this is, the lighting is so great throughout this whole thing. Douglas Slocum just killed it, but it shows that, you know, this is kind of his his only route because he's willing to go back to this woman that he really wronged and hasn't seen in so long. And then this reveals pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. And we all know where that ends up.
Around Mr. T's neck.
Rocky III.
That's the 10 pounds of gold, Daddy. Now, if this thing is so precious.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll get back to it.
Just leave it right there for Harley to grab.
For no reason.
Oh, this guy. This piece of work.
Another great villain introduction.
Fritz von Erich.
Just from the lighting and this guy's voice, you know he's a piece of crap.
Yeah.
Interesting how many people wear fedoras in this movie. It's a very classy film.
And it's funny how German has like this association as a language to be evil. has some ring to it, right? I don't know how to say it.
Well, this was ring, you know? Was this during the Second World War or right before it?
I don't know.
It's got to be during, because they talk about Hitler like Hitler's right. a known guy.
Yeah, because he was looking for the Covenant, the Ark of the Covenant, to win the war.
Yes.
Damn you, Jimmy Uso.
That's right. Shout out to all the wrestling fans out there.
Iron Muscle. Iron Muscle.
If you got a problem, Simone's is solve it. I just love that this guy gets his comeuppance so immediately.
Yeah.
You have to wait to the end. He gets a big time comeuppance at the end, but he gets it here too fairly quickly.
So this movie takes place in 1936. So it's before World War II.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
It's when Hitler was just, you know, starting to rise to power.
Oh, okay.
And then the third one is during or on the cusp of the Second World War, I think.
Yeah, cusp of World War II.
That was one thing that I, nice whip action. One of the things that was disappointing about the fourth one, if it exists, is that, and they couldn't do anything because too much time had passed, but they just skipped over the Second World War and told us he's a war hero. Well, I wanted to see that. That's a movie right there.
If they had been able to make movies in between, and like they really should have,
yeah.
If they wanted to just keep going, that would have been nice to see.
Would have been amazing. Indy in the war.
Yeah.
Ooh.
I love this stuff in old movies, like where this is all real fire. Yeah. There was no faking fire. This is all real. Like, this set would have been hot as hell.
If Steve Austin was watching this, he'd say, "You got good fire, kid. Good fire."
And that's a nice shot where Marion takes a drink while they're in the middle of this. It just establishes what kind of broad she is.
Yeah. I'm so glad Scott's on the call so I can keep popping him with the wrestling references.
they're going over my head.
We got a battle royal going on here. Royal Rumble.
It's quite the four horsemen with, like, the German guy, the 1920s gangster, and the Usos. I don't know how they all hooked up, but
oh, beautiful effect with the fire on the bar.
Yeah.
And it's quiet. It's like this, it's this unsettling calm brawl.
That's Spielberg, right?
Yeah. I just
He had a cameo. I think he shaved his head to look like he was balding that way. I don't know if that was a natural, "Oh, you deserve it, you piece of slime."
And this moment would be later homaged in Home Alone.
Oh, yeah. That's so satisfying. But it's also, it serves a purpose. He gets half the, whatever, the design, the map.
Yeah.
Chair to the back. No headshots.
This movie has quite a few people getting shot with somebody in the back and looking stunned and falling over.
Yeah, definitely different feel, different violence level than the others. I don't think they ever thought this was going to become what it became. Just kind of it's very similar to Rambo, where the first one was this really serious story about a war vet with PTSD, and then the second one was a live action cartoon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is just such a classy effect for the traveling. Makes it straightforward, no messing around.
You could make anybody's day look interesting by doing this. You could do a map of yourself driving to the supermarket, driving to the pharmacy.
The indie music behind it.
You put John Williams on, it's like, wow, it's an exciting life. There he is.
And here Skinny we go, Sala. John Rhys Davies.
Now the movie starts, you blistering idiot. big Sliders fan. That's his catchphrase from that show. And oh, he's looking svelte.
Yeah. What is this, Junior?
I like that we meet all these people that Indy has had previous relationships with, and we can glean sort of their history very quickly. In a way that's not overwhelming, but just makes it feel like a lived-in world.
And it's neat that he has really good friends everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it speaks to what kind of a man he is.
Yeah. He's greedy, but he's also a good guy. And, you know, and it instantly gets Sala over as a good guy, too.
Yeah.
Sala gets the indie rub.
I had heard that Sala, or John Rhys Davies, wasn't impressed with Ford and Connery, or at least the way everyone fawned over them. He said in interviews how everyone was just gaga over them and the novelty of them together, and so he kind of felt pushed to the back, lost in the shuffle. So
maybe it's those comments that explain why he wasn't in.
Either not invited or chose not to come back. You know, why bother? But sorely, sorely missed in a fourth movie, if it exists.
So is Sala like just a labor guy? Like he hires laborers or something? Or do they say what he does?
He's like a well-connected
businessman, right?
Yeah, he's a well-connected guy about town.
Which they really reduced him in the third movie to just some schlub. Like he didn't seem all that smart or with it, but the Camel's Indie.
it was him and Marcus Brody both became the bumbling comic relief.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
They did that to both of them.
He couldn't have been impressed with that. He saved Indy's life in this movie. Like he catches that poison date, bad dates. Yeah, so Indy would have died without Sala's reflexes and wherewithal, smarts. And then the third one, he's just trying to steal a camel during a fight. I do love that scene in the third one with Brody, though, where he's laughing and trying to get Brody to run, but Brody's too clueless.
The papers,
yes. Run.
One could say that it's like Chewbacca, right?
yeah, very close. Coming up on the... this looks like a good guy. It's Dean Ambrose. Oh, even the monkey. You got to be kidding me.
The monkey gets what he deserves.
You got to wonder how horribly Harrison Ford felt shooting these scenes, because didn't he have food poisoning or some kind of illness? It's the reason
that's the famous scene coming up.
Yeah. And that's another, you know, it was a different time scene. They'd never do that now. And like as evidenced by what they did to Han shooting first. Mm-hmm. You know, they'd never let Indy just kill a guy in cold blood. All he had was a sword. Really interesting music choice.
Yeah, it's yeah. What makes it feel like fun hijinks in the market.
Yeah, it's cute. This could be horrific, but it's cute. Remember, it's a fun movie.
It does make you think, like, okay, our main guys are not going to die here because the music is not serious enough for them to die, but we're still having a good time with the physicality, and people are getting killed.
I got the biggest smile on my face watching Indy throw punches and kicks and dodging stabs, and another guy gets stabbed. Like,
yeah,
that's just so awesome seeing Indy do his like physical punching and kicking thing.
And this all goes back to kind of like a swashbuckling, you know, element of those old serials. High adventure, Andy, yeah. Over the top villains and violence, but all in good fun.
Ow.
Like slaps, that's like a Three Stooges bit, but it works.
Yeah. That's a brutal bump on the curb right there. That must have been Harley.
Bumping the bats.
Bumping for the business, Daddy. You know, I was surprised, Scott, earlier in the movie that Harley didn't do a blade job when he hit the ground. Blading for the business.
The monkey.
Oh, that little bugger.
Bastard.
Yeah. And he would find work again, I think, 2 years after this as Salacious B. Crumb in Return of the Jedi.
Exactly.
Then his later years as the monkey in Pirates of the Caribbean.
That's right. There's the famous, look how drenched Ford is. He is really sick.
Yeah.
Another classic.
I love the adjustment of the hat. It's more of like a comedic adjustment. It's without the brim pulled down and cool, it's pulled up more in a comedic look. So just a little touch that the actor knows to do.
If I am not mistaken, that was an improvisation moment, right?
Yeah, he was supposed to grab the sword with a whip.
And a lot of gems during the 80s.
And they couldn't do it because he was so sick. I think he had food poisoning or some sort of illness. And he just couldn't get it right. And he was like, look, I just want to go and pass out. Can I just shoot him?
Yeah. And it's now a classic indie moment, but it totally is a Han Solo moment too.
And they call back to it or call forward depending on the continuity. But in Temple of Doom, when he reaches for the gun and it's not there.
Yeah.
Which when you think of it, doesn't make sense if that happened before this movie. Unless he does it all the time.
He does it all the time. He just can't be bothered.
Which reminds me, Young Indiana Jones, any of you guys ever watch that show?
Yeah.
In a while.
No.
I watched it when it was airing, so it's been decades.
I never saw much of it.
It never came here, I think.
I always thought it just wasn't very indie. And not just with, like, obviously it couldn't have the budget of an Indiana Jones movie, but it just didn't have that type of fun, swashbuckling feel to it. It felt more like an educational program that air in school.
Yeah, it definitely, some of the episodes are really good, but they're kind of few and far between.
Yeah, there's far too many episodes to have to watch the whole thing to get those. Although the one where Ford had a cameo was fantastic, The Mystery of the Blues. He actually appears in bookends in one episode with a beard, and he's going after something. Which really showed you how much he loved the character, that he would do this cameo on a TV show.
This was the moment that Harrison Ford selected when he was paying homage to John Williams in the Life Achievement Award or something.
This moment?
The moment where he's drinking, thinking in Marion.
Okay.
Yeah.
With the music.
He should have known. Belloc vaping before it was cool.
Is that what he's doing?
I think Belloc is so appropriate, like a villain, so appropriate, like Tarkin is in Star Wars. It's like the perfect role. Perfect casting.
I'm surprised that it wasn't the same actor playing Belloc in this movie.
Yeah, with all the like Lucasfilm ties, you would have thought.
Or Mark Hamill. Should have given Mark Hamill a payday. Mark Hamill is Belloc.
Now, how distracting would it have been, though, to have more than one Star Wars alum in this after Star Wars was such a worldwide phenomenon?
Yeah, like Carrie Fisher Warwick as Davis. Marine.
Where is Warwick Davis here?
Oh, yeah. Warwick Davis would be the monkey. I don't know. Like, instead of monkey, it would be Warwick Davis. Like, I'm not saying he would play a monkey. Just
they find a way.
Of course.
Was there any reason, like, the people Indy kind of has his nemesis in this one and Last Crusade both have that white hat?
Oh, that's a good point. I never put that together.
I think it's probably to juxtapose with Indy's dark hat.
Is that why, yeah?
Yeah, he kind of looks like a dandy all dressed up in white or just off-white. Same with the guy in the third movie. It's interesting that Indy's drunk here. He's drowning his sorrows. He's talking like Jonathan Frakes in those slowed down mystery show thing he did. Oh, it's lucky he's beloved. You think Short Round's in there somewhere?
One of those kids should be Warwick, right?
yes.
Well,
Warwick would have been
solid like child number five.
Warwick would have been a teenager at this point, or even younger. He was a kid when he was in Return of the Jedi.
Yeah, and Return of the Jedi was a couple years after this. So
it could be. Is it? I'm taking a look at the kids.
He wasn't discovered yet, unfortunately.
Moment of fame.
It's a sweet moment.
It's very loved.
You know, this, of all the indie movies, I would say this is the most mature, but it's nice that there's a moment where kids literally flock him and adore him, which Sala probably paid them to do, but still, it's a nice visual. It does make him look like a hero for kids.
Mm-hmm.
Sala with the white hat, too.
Well, I like that, you know, he's not even that put out by the kids. Like, it's not like Sam Neill in Jurassic Park reaction to the kids, too.
Yeah.
Oh, just thinking, who needs Sala in the next movie? You can have Armando Alejandro playing Sala.
Bad dates. Oh, something sinister is afoot. This, look at this guy with his little Tabasco. What do you think
Tabasco
that was?
Tabasco of poison.
What could that have been?
Yeah.
Gasoline.
I'll just give these to him anyway.
Yeah, that was suspicious. But we are out of dates, so what can you do?
Man, that guy's really baked in the back there.
Yeah.
He's really on.
It is weird, like, for me to see, because Indy's costume is so iconic, to see him wear part of the costume, like no gun belt, no satchel, fedora, whip. He looks like an incomplete action figure. He looks like a figure you'd find for $3 on eBay. Incomplete.
Yeah, missing all the accessories.
That's exactly what he looks like. I've seen a lot of them on eBay. The old Kenner Indiana Jones. No hat, no whip, no belt. That was Satchel. And also, Scott, you will notice that that satchel is not that wide. Indy is a trustworthy man.
That's a deep dive right there.
Little shout out to Terry Funk out there. Oh, I just love how they tease the... I don't think I've ever noticed that before. The tease that he's going to eat it?
No?
Yeah, he was about to eat it there and they stopped him. Wait!
Yeah.
No, the monkey ate it. He dies.
Oh, he's still got one. Indy's still got one in his hand.
Yeah.
And here's the moment Sala becomes the biggest hero of the entire Indiana Jones saga.
Yeah, this, here we go. At least the monkey went in dramatic fashion.
Yeah. Thank you, Sala. That's gratitude for you. They didn't even ask him back for the second or the fourth movie.
They didn't want to have any dates in those ones.
I think Sala should be the MacGuffin in the fifth movie.
He'll have to track down Sala for some reason.
Indiana Jones in the search for Sala.
Yeah.
Looks like they're reusing the Star Wars boots.
Yeah, they do look a little bit like the Imperials.
Beautiful cinematography. Man, Spielberg really knows how to shoot a pretty movie. Or Slocum, I guess.
But and this is just a great tracking shot here while they're going through that. So...
such an exotic location. It's nice that we get a good look at it. There's no point in going to an exotic location and then just shooting actors' faces. I'm just going to sneak into the Well of Souls. This was a playset, I believe, in the old Kenner line. Oh, I hated this level in the Atari game. One of the worst Atari games ever made, right up there with E.T. Like, what do you do?
Spielberg movies did not have a good record of video games for a long time.
Sure. I'm not sure if any movie had a good game on the Atari.
Yeah, they always had bad.
It's kind of like they coasted on the poster or on the sticker on the cartridge. Like, oh, they'll buy it because...
Yeah.
Name recognition. Could have been very easy. It should have been like Jungle Hunt, if you remember that one. That'd be a great Indiana Jones game.
There was an Indiana Jones game. It was called Pitfall.
Yeah, Pitfall.
Yeah, there you go. Uh-oh. Oh no. Bumping for the
Germans
business.
Yelling at the Arab in German.
They actually they replaced John Rhys-Davies with Harley Race for that stunt right there. But they cut away before Harley hit the...
Harley just wouldn't leave the territory.
He hit the truck and cut his forehead open. Oh, this stuff is wild. It's so cool that the movie does both the fisticuffs... but also this, National Treasure style of definite National Treasure influence on this movie.
Yes, that is the way it was. And in terms of Indiana Jones knockoffs, National Treasure is one of the better ones out there, that's for sure.
Oh, give me the Mummy. Brendan Fraser.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I tried to watch those King Solomon's Mines, Alan Quartermain movies in the 80s.
Richard Chamberlain.
Not the same thing.
No.
And they thought they'd have a leg up by saying, well, Alan Quartermain came before Indiana Jones, but it just didn't come off the same.
Mm-hmm. This is such a cool moment.
It might be like the one effect, or maybe later with the arc, they have some actual visual effects.
Yeah.
It's not CGI, but that type of like post-production effect. It's really stunning. Is it? No, I vaguely remember it making a sound when it lights up.
Yeah, it does make a sound. It's like a...
Which is amazing.
Low hum or something.
Yeah, light passing through a ruby.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
There it is.
Yes, that's amazing. Oh, his face just lights up. It's amazing. That's actually an outtake, that shot where Ford is smiling. He didn't know the camera was running. That's when they gave him the check. His payment. It was needless to say, it was much higher than the Star Wars paycheck. I love that he breaks the stick. Now they'll never be able to. Oh no. This reminds me of the Aliens chow scene. She doesn't like the cornbread either. I could have sworn I saw Gorman and Weir Zbowski in there. There's Drake. Probably not going to see anyone like Frost in the Nazi army.
Probably not.
Yeah, this whole time he's thinking she's dead.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he's really choked up here. That's what I love seeing when an actor, maybe not even given the direction to do so, but the actor is like, look, man, he's going to be totally relieved. A huge weight is off his chest because she's alive. In a lot of movies, when a rescue happens, it's just like, come on, let's go. And there's no little moment. Oh, that sucks. See you in 10 years again.
So close.
It's so weird how he can just like walk around.
Yeah.
Out in the open. He's
the white guy in the Arab gear.
It kind of reminds me of Solid Snake with his cardboard box. He can just go anywhere because he's got his costume.
Nobody notices.
Like, he's not exactly subtle and discreet here. He's standing there on this thing on a hill.
Yeah, he's not really blending in very much.
White guy.
Time to sit and ponder.
Yeah.
Not in a big rush.
This dick.
Not exactly graceful again.
Just thought about it. That guy, the creepy burnt guy. Definitely know he's not German because they don't say "Hail Hitler."
I always thought
he hails him.
Yeah, I always thought he didn't look German to me. Like more,
very strange.
He kind of looks more Asian. But the actor might actually be German. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
He might, but he definitely said it weird. Yeah. I don't know if it was on purpose because they didn't want a full on.
Yeah. So they're just going to discreetly dig a giant hole here with an entire crew.
Yeah.
These Nazis aren't too perceptive.
This even, is a great looking shot.
Even puts the fedora on like, well, they're not paying attention. Now he's just flaunting it. Keep on digging, boys.
Yeah, he took everything off.
You'd think he'd dig a little. Help out. He's supervising.
Here's where we know some real weird stuff is going down. Look at this guy.
Oof. This is some really old school looking either blue screening or rear projection.
Yeah, I think it was all rotoscoped later, but it's certainly rough.
Mm-hmm. It clashes a little bit with just how natural and beautiful the rest of the movie looks.
Everything else is, yeah, it sticks out like a sore thumb now. I could almost see George Lucas being like, we need this effect. And Spielberg being like, I don't know if we need it. And Lucas being like, we need it.
Well,
trust me.
I could see Steven Spielberg saying, George, we just flash a light to kind of, you know, give the idea of lightning. No, we got to draw it on. I got this idea for the third Star Wars movie. I got to test it out here. Oh. This scene creeped me out so much. The entire Well of Souls.
Scream was
I love that reaction from Sala. Whoa!
I guess he was a little comedic in this one, too.
Yeah.
And the whole thing with, oh, asps, very deadly. You go first.
Yeah. And this is great. This is everyone's nightmare.
Oh, my God. Especially, like, they're all dark. Yuck.
Just the look Harrison gives him there. Yes. So good.
Your name is the first on the marquee. Brad Pitt School of Acting.
Always eating.
Oh, I think that's the outfit the figure came with, and that's an incredibly rare figure. It's like hundreds and hundreds of dollars of the original little figures for Indiana Jones in the style of the Star Wars figures.
Yeah.
Huh, it's beautiful.
Well, and this is a scene that you see in a lot of movies where the villain buys a dress for the hostage and makes her put it on.
Yeah. You don't see that anymore these days. Different time.
This peeping Tom bastard.
Yeah. A little bit of skin. That's about as much skin as you'll ever see in any indie movie. Unless it's Indy's skin. She's so subtle. Oh my God.
I just love the statues look so awesome.
Descending into this pit. Yikes.
Like, this is insane.
Oof. Ah, the cobra.
And of course, over the years, they fixed that shot where they took out the glass that you could see the reflection.
Oh, I thought I could see a little bit in the bottom corner there, but I was trying not to look at it because, you know, it takes away from the danger of the shot.
Yeah. On like all the Blu-rays and stuff, they've fixed it.
I'm surprised George didn't add like flames coming out of the snake's eyes.
I think Spielberg was putting the kibosh on that pretty quick.
It's so interesting that the new indie movie won't have George Lucas or Steven Spielberg on it. Well, you mentioned though, Spielberg is still executive director or a producer.
Yeah. So, yeah, producing.
So no involvement by George Lucas at all.
Nope.
Wow.
George is out.
He still gets probably some residuals.
George is counting his money.
He's named after my dog. I get something. I love that.
Seems fair.
If anyone out there is wondering what happened to Pablo, he had to step away for a moment or two.
You're no Harley Race.
Wild that the Ark of the Covenant is in an old Egyptian tomb.
Mm-hmm.
You guys think it actually still exists somewhere? Or did even exist?
I don't know. I'm sure something somewhere was out there, but whether that's still waiting to be found is probably unlikely.
What do you think, Scott?
It's in a warehouse somewhere.
It's hanging above a ring in Japan.
I'm sure the item existed. I don't know in what form.
Or if it was magical.
Supernatural right, yeah. Abilities.
Yeah. Like, I'm sure the item itself existed.
Just a question of if it was actually imbued with the power of God.
Right.
That looks pretty heavy.
Man, that's crazy heavy.
That did look like it had some heft to it. Usually you can tell if it's styrofoam bouncing down like that.
Yeah.
Probably a practical joke. Try to give them hernias. Who gets a hernia first? That is why I sat out the second movie.
Yeah.
I had the groin injury, the legs you've never seen.
And I like how this is kind of subverting our expectations because, you know, we didn't think Marion could get drunk under the table.
She is.
And then she's not.
And then she is?
She's still kind of trashed because this guy actually could keep up pretty good. But
well, he had a
it
vineyard,
made it
right?
seem like she was, you know, stumbling drunk and she's still functional.
Yeah, it's his vineyard. Uh-oh. Fritz von Erich again. He's got the iron claw on her. See?
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't hold on to the knife. The power of the iron claw. Here's a... I don't want to...
I don't know who to call that, man.
I don't want to say Carrie and Kevin, because the boys...
I love this. This is one of Spielberg's favorite bits.
Oh, the nunchucks into the...
Where we think that it's a torture device and it's just a coat hanger.
I think it is a torture device, and he's just that twisted to hang a jacket on a torture device. Oh, he's so slimy. He reminds me of that inconceivable guy.
Yeah, Wallace Shawn.
I just love how the arc is like emitting this golden reflection.
And they use that golden light a lot in this movie, and it really works to just instill that sense of wonder.
Beautiful. Yours with five proofs of purchase in 1995. That was a really cool mail away when all of the new indie toys were coming out around the time of Crystal Skull. They were doing some 12-inch Indiana Jones figures. You know, cheap ones that you could get at Toys R Us or Walmart. But if you sent in a certain number of proofs of purchase, you could get the ARC, like a 12-inch figure-sized ARC. And it was all gold chrome, just beautiful. But such a bugger that you had to, it was a mail away. It wasn't like widely available.
Right. Yeah.
It's definitely Indy's most awkward steal. It's really hard to transport. Uh-oh. I finally noticed something. I mean, not to nitpick, but come on. maybe there could have been a way to kind of shoot that more discreetly so that they're not actually on the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
Put up a sheet or something. I don't know. Don't blame Sala. Guy saved his life, and then half hour later, he's angry at him. Awesome. Yeah, it's interesting. There's no swearing in this movie.
That's pretty much as bad as it gets.
No empathy for Belloc right there.
Hey guys, sorry. I'm back.
Hey, no problem.
Welcome
no
back.
That's a lot of snakes. Where do you get them?
Yeah, they must have really had couple of snake wranglers to make that possible.
Great work from the part of the snakes, right? Especially for acting.
There are so many different snakes in there, too. That looks like a python, asps, a cobra. It's a real medley.
Yeah.
Continuity is for crying babies. Something like that said George Lucas, right? For whims. That's...
Classic. Kick in the music and everything just becomes high adventure.
Mm-hmm. The shoe.
The Mummy blatantly ripped off a lot of this movie.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it does it in a way that it feels like a loving homage, but, like, tons of this is... been repurposed by the Mummy.
Oh, I was thinking of the movie. Horrible. It's so weird because when this is practical, you can almost feel the texture of the things that you are seeing.
That came out really easily for having been there for thousands of years.
Yeah, the rest of the pyramid looks really sturdy, except for those two stones.
Yeah. It's like, that's the Atari level.
Carvings.
Well, it looks like they've been messing around with it. So maybe they opened it up and just temporarily sealed it.
This was also one of my classics images of this movie from my childhood, this whole mm-hmm. thing with the airplane and all of that. Very iconic.
This whole sequence is just great.
These Germans love their black leather gloves. They're really ripping off Hannibal from the A-Team here.
And this is one of those great, like, okay, as soon as we see this setup, we know somebody's getting propellered.
Yeah, I mean, Steven Spielberg knows how to make situation tense. Is like the same thing in Jurassic Park, that he knows how to control these elements.
Yeah. And I just love Ford is just like, oh God, why? Wishes he had his gun just to shoot this dude.
Which is huge.
I love that fall.
Weak in the knees.
He's just so not into this fight. Ooh.
Fighting dirty.
Ooh. It's almost like a dance. More of a dance than a fight. Oh, missed. The salt in the eyes. Man, he's getting destroyed. It's like Brock Lesnar versus John Cena at SummerSlam. It's like Andre versus Hogan for the first 2 minutes.
I just like that this is all barely contained chaos.
Yeah. And she's kicking such major butt with that Gatling gun. It's nice that she's not just locked and helpless.
And when you think it can't get worse, that happens.
Yeah. And the danger of the wheels about to crush him too. It's a great little set to fight around.
Yeah, this is one of those like really well orchestrated set pieces that utilizes every element just right.
Even though it's moving so slowly. These guys are so slow to notice things happening in plain sight. Look at that black smoke. What is that? That black smoke has been there for 7 minutes. What is that?
Oh, Baron von Raschke just won't give up.
He's trying to apply the claw. Oh, he's got the claw on in his hand. Matt, you'd be enjoying this so much more if you were a wrestling fan. Probably. Oh, man. He butchered him, and it had no effect.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. Oh.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Face first.
Oh. And I think we're coming up on one of maybe the most awesome action sequence in any of the indie movies. One of them, anyway. The truck. In a bit.
Yeah. Well, and that's what this whole movie just, you know, is a string between fantastic action sequences, but luckily the connecting tissue is just as good.
Yeah, it's very well directed. You don't lose in the action, right?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that a short round line? Holy smoke.
No time for love, Dr. Jones.
Hey, I just realized something. Temple of Doom takes place before this movie.
Yeah.
Holy smoke. Short round is Sala. That was Sala as a kid.
So... wasn't Sala like a... Okay, so they captured Sala out of the Well of Souls.
Right.
Let him go and then tell him where they're sending the Ark?
Yeah.
I think because they don't think he's a threat. He's just, you know, this well-connected guy about town, so they don't necessarily think he was helping Indy.
It is weird how easily he got away.
He is well connected. You always think of something.
The horse. Gotta have that cowboy moment.
Yeah, it's just cinematic. Unbelievable.
This movie just must have blown people's minds when it came out.
Yeah,
in the cinema, right?
Like, it might have been inspired by the serials, but there was nothing the size and scope of this. Serials were just, 22-minute little TV episodes, or maybe even shorter?
Yeah.
But this is just one of the most amazing adventure movies of all time. It pretty much defines the term adventure movie.
It does. And to think that, you know, George Lucas and Kasdan together, this and then Empire Strikes Back, like one of the best collaborations ever. Mm-hmm. Insane for one guy to have written two of the most influential movies of all time.
I can see Ford being so in love with the character after doing this movie, like always trying to get back to this high mark.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing he's doing this all by himself.
Oh, the Wilhelm.
Yeah. Like he's actually pulling this off. A one man war against the Nazis.
Yeah.
In a pretty believable like John I love that little in a pretty believable John McClane way. Oh my god, he ate that. Harley earning his pay. And then he cut himself. Harley, you don't have to keep cutting yourself. We cut. It's for the business, Daddy. Red means green. I like this little, I think it's coming up here, the little shimmy he gives. It's like a little mischievous, runs a guy off a road. Yeah.
Boom.
Oh, scheisse.
Forgot about that one.
He's having fun. That's what's so great about this.
And this feels like they tried to get back the magic.
That's it right there. He really enjoyed that motorcycle.
They tried to get back the magic of this scene in Crystal Skull with that big chase scene through the jungle on the cliffside and stuff, and it just wasn't even close to the same.
Wow. It has the look of an old movie, right? I mean, like The Great Escape or something like that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Imagine Steve McQueen as Indiana Jones. If he had lived.
Would definitely have a different feel.
Yeah. Same with Tom Selleck. I like Tom Selleck, but I just don't see Magnum as Indy. And I don't see Ford as Magnum.
No.
Oh.
Oui.
The mist. The red mist, Daddy. When you see that red mist, it's on, brother. And there's blood all over the windshield, too. Little blood streaks. Really ate that one.
I remember one afternoon, this movie was playing in the TV, open TV, and my mother doesn't watch any movie so much, but the movie was playing and she was looking this and she can don't look two other way, you know? She was very immersed in this sequence, even she.
So interesting to see Paul Hogan years before Crocodile Dundee. Ripper, good day, mate. Looks like Paul Hogan. Totally looks like Paul Hogan. That's not a knife. That's not a whip. That's a whip. Oh, amazing. Just love this sequence underneath the truck. How many kids wanted to try this with their parents' car? Close the door. What are you doing? I just want to go under.
Oh, and it's for things like this that Spielberg and George Lucas passed to the story, right, of the movies.
Yeah, amazing. Just amazing. And I know they slowed the truck down to probably like 10 miles an hour to get that shot of him being dragged. Because if they were going the full 50. Oh, oh no, crikey. Oh. He is not going to have a good day, mate. Oh, no.
That's horrible. Went under the wheels.
He went under the wheels.
You sure Paul Hogan's dead? He went under the wheels.
Man, Indy's a road warrior here. Got to sell the injury. And I love that that was completely improvised, making it up as I go. Man, it really, it's handy to have a well-connected guy in town.
No doubt.
So if he's so well-connected, I guess he must have fallen on hard times, because he was just scrambling for those camels in the third movie.
And a lot has happened probably in between this and Last Crusade. Maybe as a result of his actions in this.
Oh, maybe. Blackballed.
Yeah.
Perhaps the government took out the kids from him.
Saul lost his kids. He's getting divorced.
He couldn't make him work anymore. Make them work anymore.
This captain seems like everyone gets a big intro in this movie. Except maybe Sala. But this captain got a nice little intro shot there, and I don't think he really does anything in the movie.
Not really.
Hired an older Mario Van Peebles. Or Slick. Take your pick.
See you in the third movie. I'm already missing Sala. This is so sweet.
Oh, that's so sweet.
The awkwardly placed horn. Now I'm going to go sliding.
What I'm going to tell him home.
Now I'm going to go explore Middle Earth.
With roaring fires and not beer.
Nobody tosses Sala. It's the it's not the years, it's the mileage scene.
Mm-hmm.
Good thing that they actually take a moment to tend to his wounds, because he's been through the ringer now. As long as he can go injury free for a while and recover. Oops.
It's just, it's such a goofy comedic moment, but it works.
The scream. That was actually Harley taking that bump. I could have sworn when the fourth movie came out, I saw a commercial where he says it's not the mileage, it's the years. Maybe it was just in print.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
bionic elbow, daddy. It's invincible, baby. Of course the elbow doesn't hurt. It's bionic.
What are you going to do, Andy? I think of something today.
Stay awake. Stay awake.
Even when he's beat up, he's still a smooth operator.
Oh.
Oh, man.
You suck, Andy.
Yeah, the movie's PG.
Dude, you dig a fork in your leg or something. You stay awake. Yeah, that's pretty much it, right? That's enough snogging. This is an adventure, not a love story. Oh, this is eerie. God does not like Nazis. Neither do rats.
These rats.
How do they?
It's just, how did they do that?
It looks so. It must be like a rewound footage, shuttled forward and backward, because it's an unnatural movement. Oh, there is profanity in this movie. I forgot about that.
Oh.
Sean Connery in Red October. Junior.
It's dad. Now, it's dad.
Does Indy swear in Temple of Doom before the plane crashes at the beginning?
I think he does.
So there is. They do drop an S-bomb. It is quite a bit more violent than Star Wars.
Sometimes this movie?
So you do want to drop one S-bomb just to let people know, hey, this kids shouldn't watch this on their own. Star Wars never really had much blood and gore. Lots of people die in this movie.
Yeah, basically because lightsabers and laser cannons and stuff don't really leave wounds like this movie does.
You don't spew blood out of your mouth when you get shot in the head. Mm-hmm. I just can't catch a break.
Oh. Viggo Mortensen, when did you say?
Yeah. Or Stan Lane, sweet Stan. That's a bit of a stretch. Oh, you double crosser, old Mario Van Peebles.
Or Yaphet Kotto.
Oh yes, it is.
Who that is?
It does look like a young Yaphet.
Yeah.
Star of The Park Is Mine, co-star. This kind of looks like it was shot on the water. Maybe beside it. You'd think Spielberg would never go back to the water after Jaws.
Yeah, nothing too extensive.
The sub is not working. Repeat, the sub is not working.
Thanks, Captain Obvious.
Cedric Alexander.
That's pretty good. That's good.
There's Sika the Wild Samoan beside him.
Is that Jim Brown?
Oh, he swam. This guy can do it all.
Yeah, American hero.
That's a quite a swim there.
They're all happy.
Way to go, because we didn't do anything.
Better him than us.
Oh, I forgot my hat. Yeah, see, in the other movies, they really don't let him go without his hat. It's part of the whole iconic look to him. But in this movie, it was a part of his costume, but it wasn't, you know, if he lost his leather jacket or his whip, or it didn't really matter. It definitely feels like in the second and third and fourth, like, oh, it's not Indy unless he has the whole getup. It's kind of like Terry Funk without his branding iron. Or Harley Race without his bathrobe. If he can get a costume, he'll be able to go wherever he wants and do whatever he wants.
Yeah.
Because that's how these disguises work in the indie movies. This is one of my favorite parts of any video game like Metal Gear. If you can just get an enemy uniform and just freely walk around wherever you want.
You can be a general.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can pass like a general.
You can dress up like the Fuhrer and everyone salutes you. And they just don't suspect a thing. So it looks like they went to the effort of getting quite a few blonde-haired, blue-eyed extras to play the Nazis, going for that Aryan race.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. See, he's still technically wearing the outfit, so he's sort of fooling the guy, even though it doesn't fit. Fight's so dirty. Does look like Stan Lane. Oh, can you imagine if they waited to open it in front of Hitler? History would have been so different. The gall to bump into him, like he could have just blown the whole mission. Gotta get my digs in. It is quite satisfying that this many Nazis get melted. Oh, leather jacket was a bad choice.
That's true.
He doesn't even walk like them.
No gun, no nothing.
Yeah, just sauntering, hunched, unshaved, no undershirt. How did he get up there that fast? Jump cut, I guess. Oh, that bug went into his mouth.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, no, that's a pro. It went right into his mouth. That they didn't fix. Does he even know how to shoot that thing?
He just knows.
He just knows.
Makes it up as he goes along. That's not one of those sweet Russian grenade launchers that Rambo used. And the villain talks the hero into surrendering.
Yeah.
Another thing that's very unlike any other indie movie.
We all want to see what is in the box, right?
Yeah.
And this is one of those great sequences where, you know, became iconic. And the special effects in this part coming up are dated, but they still work for the most part.
Yeah, and the world of India. Sure.
The face melting is still some of the best stuff ever. And this is kind of like a make or break point for the movie where we really go into the supernatural stuff. But because it's been so grounded and felt relatable, I think a lot of people didn't have a problem going with it. You know, you can rail against it if you want, but the way that Spielberg has done the whole movie up to this point, it doesn't feel too out of left field. There's been small hints that this was coming.
Yeah, for me, it's in the core of the franchise, right? I mean, like I was saying at the beginning, it's about the mystery of the world has to offer. So I am willing to accept many of these things.
And because it's all Nazis getting their comeuppance, I don't think a lot of people will have a problem with it. This is just a cool effect.
It's nice that it's a combination of a sort of a blue screen effect and practical smoke coming up out of it. That's how you make CGI or blue screen effects most convincing, when you actually combine an actual real practical effect with it. Such a great, like, adventure hero movie, but the hero does not save the day.
Right.
He has nothing to do with this.
The villains do themselves in.
Yeah. Like, Indy had no, there's no part here where he cuts the ropes and escapes and we got to get out of here. He just plays no part. Other than warning Marion to keep her eyes shut.
And this is the moment where it all changes.
Oh no. That's
great. Get her.
Don't look, it's Indy 4. They're screening the Crystal Skull.
And this is just so awesome. Like, die, you bastards.
Oh, even the cameraman.
Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter.
Some of the grossest practical effects in a movie this rating ever. Oh, yeah.
Carpenter's watching this going, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Good idea.
And then all of this, it's just so so cool.
And the fact that Indy is spared by God, the power of God, they never really come right out and say this thing is spiritual or imbued with the power of God until this moment. Like, there's no ambiguity here. And Indy is spared by God. Like, that's, talk about being smashed over. That's like pinning Andre in the Pontiac Silverdome level of being over.
I heard God was really angry that day. Still let him get over.
Slam me, boss. I mean, God. And God burned the ropes. Or, you know, what? Supernatural force.
Yeah.
I thought that was a nice touch that he didn't have to saw his way out of there.
Yeah.
That he's just been spared and deemed worthy. It's very similar to Last Crusade. The penitent men shall pass. He's spared because he kneels, sort of. He's spared here because he doesn't dare look upon. Horkins is back. I like that Indy has a friend here who is equally disappointed in this decision. It's not just the hero is so frustrated, but Marcus Brody thinks it's a bunch of bunk too.
Yeah.
And this, I understand, was a late addition to the movie. Just to kind of put a bow on the movie and make it not seem so bittersweet, or just plain bitter.
I'm glad that they never revisited the arc, really.
Yeah.
Because there would have been a temptation for like another storyline where somebody does dig it out of that warehouse.
If they were going to do it, Crystal Skull, I think, the fourth movie would have been the time to do it. Like something from his past.
Mm-hmm.
But there would have been no point in doing the sequel with the arc or the third one with the arc. And the Holy Grail was the perfect choice for the third one.
Oh, yeah.
I think religious artifacts are the perfect thing for Indy to go after because he's an atheist despite all of this proof of God.
But don't worry, guys. We will see it again in episode 4.
Right. Ark of the Covenant. You sure?
Are you sure? Are you sure? Pretty sure.
Wow. What do you think is in there? Are those Kenner Star Wars action figures?
They're E.T. Atari video games.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, E.T. video games.
I know where we can store them. I got a warehouse in Pasadena.
Kathleen Kennedy.
Oh, there she is. Associate to Mr. Spielberg.
Mr. Spielberg.
Chick Watterson. Frank Burt. No, Bruton. I thought that was my uncle. Frank Bruton.
One of the great movies, you know, Spielberg has made so many classics, but Raiders is definitely top five.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic.
Such a winning combination.
Infinitely rewatchable.
For sure.
Which we just proved, because I don't know how many times I've watched this movie, but still amazing.
Yeah.
Hey, I got an idea. What do you guys say we talk about what we thought was the best and the worst part of this movie?
Yeah. Oh,
great.
Novel.
Scott, kick it off.
My best part was I love the music. I saw this after Temple of Doom. I love the music. It's not my favorite Indiana Jones movie, but it's a great movie. Worst part, I mean, it's such a nitpick, but the effects, they are dated because they're older. That's the only really thing I can complain about.
Yeah. Pablo, what do you think?
Okay, well, my best part is the collaboration between John Williams, Spielberg, George Lucas, and, of course, Harrison Ford, in the sense that they are all four in their best. You know, this is the perfect collaboration, I think, because the story is great, the direction is great, the music, of course, and the acting
you can tell by now was of the magical performance of Harrison Ford. So you have to acknowledge that. And my worst part, I would say the music moment in the that you guys mentioned, where the fight in the desert is unfolding. Mm-hmm. Because it felt like probably I remember like this serial that a genie, a woman genie in a bottle, you know, in that kind of comedy, you know. So that doesn't feel appropriate for this movie, but it's a nitpick, as everyone else said.
Mm-hmm. Matt,
I'm gonna say best part. It's tough because this is basically a perfect movie for me. So best part, you know, just the way that Spielberg handles all the action sequences so that every camera movement feels important. It feels like everything we can tell what's happening. You're never confused about what's going on. Just movie magic from start to finish. And worst part is just that small nitpick where literally for no reason that supernatural-esque sky at like the 1 hour mark that doesn't feel right when you watch this, because the effects near the end are fine. They feel fine even though they're a little dated, but just when they're at the Well of Souls or whatever and the sky, I don't love that part.
Yeah, that was the worst part for me too, just the sky. And unnecessary. When they pull it out of the whatever it was in, the stone tomb it was in, they could have done a quick cutaway shot to the guys outside looking up at the sky and just have a quick, even stock footage of lightning strike.
Yeah.
Just as quick as that, instead of like so much footage of these guys on however they did it. Best part, I love that truck sequence. Especially dragging under the truck. That's so legendary. And then and then knocking Paul Hogan out of the truck and running him over. love it.
Classic movie. Glad you guys could join us.
Yeah, thanks so much, Scott and Popo.
Oh,
it was great.
Thanks
for the invitation, guys, as always.
Awesome. And thank you to everyone on the Armchair Directors Patreon for voting for this one. It was actually a tie between this one and Dark Knight, right?
Yeah.
Figured this one would probably be a little more fun at the moment.
At the moment, you know, this is a good one to turn off your worries and enjoy this for 2 hours.
Yeah.
And we'll do Dark Knight soon enough.
Yeah. So thanks for everyone who's on the Patreon. Thanks everyone out there watching along, listening to this one. Thanks for supporting Armchair Directors over a glorious decade, 10 glorious years, to paraphrase Larry Zbysko. We've had a blast, and we're going to keep on going. Scott and Pablo, once again, thanks so much, guys, for joining us tonight.
Thanks to you, okay.
And Matt,
thank pleasure, you guys.
Pleasure as always, Matt. And everyone out there, stay safe, stay positive. We'll get through this. All right, guys, enjoy the show. Take care.
Bye.
Take care, guys.